As we know, bronchial asthma is common in adult, but it is less known that it is also very common in children. Most of the population in our country, as well as in the Western country, initially they do not believe that bronchial asthma do exist in children also. So, but in the research basis, it has shown that 80% of the cases of asthma in children will start before 6 years of age. So it is very common in children as well. Bronchial asthma is a chronic inflammatory condition of lungs, airways, resulting in episodic, widespread, but variable obstruction. It is generally reversible, either spontaneously or with the treatment. So here in the bronchial asthma, it's a chronic condition. It's not an acute one. It's a chronic one. There is inflammation of the airways. And larger airway, smaller airways, bronchus, bronchioles, bronchi, all will be involved. And it is reversible. The obstruction is reversible, either spontaneously or with the medication treatment. What are the risk factors for asthma in early childhood? Number one is allergy. Those children who have atopic dermatitis, allergy of the skin, allergy, rhinitis, food allergy, those children are high risk for having asthma. It has shown that around 40% of the children with allergic rhinitis has some sort of bronchial asthma. There is parental asthma. If the mother or father have asthma, so it is their siblings are high risk of having bronchial asthma in the future. Male gender, exact cause is not known. So male are more prone to develop bronchial asthma compared to the female one. Other risk factor, like those children born by low birth weight, environmental exposure with the smoke, tobacco during the early childhood, or if mother is a smoker during pregnancy, those children have having high risk of having bronchial asthma. Severe lower respiratory tract infection, like bronchiolitis requiring hospitalization, are prone to develop bronchial asthma in the future. So these are the risk factors of bronchial asthma in children. What are the factors that will trigger the attack of asthma? Children already have asthma, or certain factors are there which can trigger the disease, like allergy. So allergy, any sort of allergy, any aero allergen like house dust, cockroaches, smoke, pollens, these all factors will trigger the bronchial asthma. Any children who takes aspirin, okay, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, any children who suffer from viral infection, underlying bronchial asthma will get flare up. These are the triggering factor. Other one, like exercise, sometimes exercise induced bronchial asthma is there. When they play, runs, the asthma will flare up. Weather change, emotional factor, food has got insignificant role, but some food like nuts, eggs, cow's milk, they can trigger the bronchial asthma. Endocrine factors, like those children who are having hypothyroidism, those children who are having Cushing's disease, or those children who are obese, those factors can trigger the bronchial asthma. What is the pathogenesis of the bronchial asthma? Number one is airway obstruction. So airway obstruction results from various pathological processes like there will be edema and inflammation of the mucous membrane lining the airways. So edema and inflammation that will narrow down the airway caliber, causing obstruction. And later there will be deposition of excessive secretion mucous material, inflammatory cells, mostly of eosinophils, and cellular debris. Edema inflammation will narrow the airway. Further narrowing will cause by the deposition of the mucus, inflammatory cells, cellular debris. The airway get further narrowed. And there will be spasm of the smooth muscles of the bronchi. That will further narrow down the airways. The hallmark of bronchial asthma is the airway obstruction that caused by the edema inflammation, deposition of the mucus, materials, inflammatory cells, cellular debris, spasm of the bronchial smooth muscles. So how does the inflammation occur? Inflammation occurs due to hyper-responsiveness and remodeling. Asthmatic children airway have increased number of mast cells, activated eosinophils, activated helper T lymphocytes that produce pro-allergic, pro-inflammatory cytokines like interleukin-4, interleukin-5, interleukin-13, and chemokines. Yes, reversible airway changes include basement membrane thickening, subepithelial collagen deposition, smooth muscle and mucous gland hypertrophy. They are not reversible, very less reversible. With the treatment, very less reversible. Inhaled allergy challenges studies have revealed two distinct phases of airway obstruction. Our airway obstruction occurs in two distinct phases. One is early phase, other one is late phase. What will happen in the early phase? Early phase will start within 15 to 30 minutes of exposure to the allergen. Once the children with bronchial asthma get exposed to the allergic material, so within 15 to 30 minutes it will start. It will be characterized by release of histamine, leukotrienes, prostaglandins, platelet activating factor PAF, and bradykinin from the mast cells. So in early phase, once the children exposed with the allergen, within 30 minutes these substances are released from the airway. In the late phase, exposure occur means after 4 to 12 hours of after allergen exposure. The late phase start, which is characterized by release of mast cells mediator. There is inflammatory reactions and mucosal edema. In this way, the inflammatory reaction will occur that will cause the inflammation of the respiratory epithelium and mucus lining the airway epithelium will become edematous. So there will be mucosal edema, which causes the narrowing of the airway. This is the picture showing, this is the normal caliber. This is the normal caliber of the airway. Once the inflammatory process will start, okay, there will be inflammation and swelling. There will be inflammation and swelling. See here the difference. There is inflammation and swelling of the airway, which will cause the narrowing of the lumen of the airway. And further, there will be excessive production of the mucus, deposition of the inflammatory cells and cellular debris, which is further narrow down the airway lumen, and contracted smooth muscles. There will be spasm of the smooth muscles of the airway. So bronchial smooth muscles will get contracted. So these all factors will cause narrowing of the airway, causing obstruction. Less of the oxygen, what we inhale, the oxygen will not reach to the capillary. So there will be ventilation perfusion mismatch will be there. See, here is the normal airway. In asthmatic airway, it is narrowed, which I have already discussed why it is narrowed. And during severe attack, it will get further narrowed. So we have to start the treatment as early as possible. So we have to reverse the narrowing of the airway by using drugs like hydrocortisone and bronchodilator. What are the clinical features of the bronchial asthma? Symptoms vary from simple recurrent cough to severe wheezing. Bronchial asthma may only have cough also. Not always will have severe respiratory distress, wheezing. Not all the asthmatic patients will have wheezing. Not all the asthmatic patients will have always have difficulty in breathing. May have simple cough also. So clinical picture wise, there may be intermittent cough. Cough will be more at night, because these chemical mediators like bradykinin more released during night. So more of cough will be there at night. And there will be wheezing. Okay, airway narrowing will be there. Wheezing is the dry musical sound which is produced through the narrow airway. Okay, due to turbulence flow of air through the narrow air passage, mostly during expiration. Wheezing. Short, this is a shortness, not shortness, shortness of breath. Okay. And chest tightness will be there. So child may have got difficulty in breathing, shortness of breath will be there, chest tightness will be there. And some older children may complain of non-focal chest pain also. Subtle symptoms like physical activity will be decreased, because there will be hypoxia. Child will get easily fatigability, difficulty in keeping up with the peers in physical activity. Child will not play as well as with their friends, because due to fatigability. Signs, children commonly present without abnormal signs. Some may exhibit dry persistent cough. Child may be dyspneic, tachypneic. There may be use of accessory muscles of respiration. On auscultation, you may find the hyporesonant sound. On percussion, on auscultation, you may find the polyphonic wheeze. Polyphonic wheeze is a different intensity of the dry musical sound which is produced due to variable airway obstruction. So here the larger caliber of the airway also get obstructed, small caliber of the airway also get obstructed. So there will be polyphonic wheezing will be there on auscultation. On percussion, hyperresonant sound. And if the symptoms get worse, there is a terminology called silent chest. Because the inhalation, exhalation of the airway will not take place. So you will not hear the vesicular breath sound, which is a normal vesicular breath sound you may not hear. That is silent chest. Sometimes in an inexperienced person, doctor, if they auscultate and they found nothing is there, and child is having sinus, that is a very severe condition. You have to be aware of that also. You can't hear the breath sound, that and child is maybe semi-conscious, unconscious, cyanosis, that is a very critical condition. Investigation wise, basically bronchial asthma is diagnosed clinically because children below 5 years of age will not able to perform the pulmonary function test. The clinical basis wise, depending on the history and on examination and some allergic test, you can suspect the bronchial asthma in children below 5 years of age. Above 5, like 7, 8 years of age, sometimes you can do the pulmonary function test and you can see the reversible airway obstruction and you can rule out the bronchial asthma. Nowadays, below 5 years of age also, infant pulmonary function test is available. Maybe in some research center, not it is commercially available. So on lung function test, spirometry you do. You have to see the FEV1, forced expiratory volume, forced vital capacity, forced expiratory volume by forced vital capacity. The ratio is FEV1 is to FVC ratio is less than 0.9, indicate airway obstruction. So in case of bronchial asthma, FEV1 will be less than 80%, okay? And FVC will also may be normal or maybe less than 80%, but this FEV1 is to FVC ratio, first you have to see the FEV1 is to FVC ratio, it will be less than 0.9. And improvement in the FEV1, more than 12%, after giving bronchodilator, that suggests the child is having reversible airway obstruction. That is one of the condition of bronchial asthma. One is peak expiratory flow rate. Morning to evening variation is less than 20% in normal patient. But if there is more than 20%, the morning PE expiratory flow rate to evening peak expiratory flow rate, that is consistent with bronchial asthma. Less than 20% normal, more than 20% sounds is bronchial asthma. And less than 80% of predicted and improvement more than or equal to 20% after bronchodilator therapy, that also indicate bronchial asthma. Etiologically, often normal unta, but sometimes you may find the hyperinflated lungs or peribronchial thickening. To do the absolute eosinophil count, there will eosinophilia will be there, like in eosinophilic bronchial asthma. Allergic test, usually we don't do the allergic test. Sometimes to know the triggering factor, you can do the allergic skin test, or you can see whether child is allergic or not, you can do the total serum IgE level, which may be increasing bronchial asthma, but in other condition also IgE level will increase. So you have to correlate clinically. It is not a definite, like serum IgE level is high, so it is bronchial asthma. Because in allergic rhinitis also it may get high. In allergic dermatitis also it may get high. So you have to correlate clinically. Differential diagnosis of bronchial asthma, because sometimes it may present with like chronic cough. We have to rule out certain other conditions like allergic rhinitis, where the children may have chronic cough as well as have running nose, rhinorrhea. Sometimes chronic rhinitis, sometimes sinusitis, they may also have chronic cough, nocturnal cough, and you have to see the examination. And in the posterior pharyngeal wall, you may find the postnasal tree. Acute bronchiolitis, which occurs between 2 months to 2 years of age, so it is not a recurrent one. So you rule out acute bronchiolitis also. Congenital malformation, like sometimes the airway get narrowed and can cause wheezing, like if there is any vascular rings is there, like double aortic arch, which can compress the airway. Otherwise, bronchiogenic cyst, which can compress the airway and can produce wheeze, here tracheobronchomalacia. Here the condition is severe one, and it gets increased day by day, and the bronchodilator will not get, will not reverse the condition. Now, the expression of foreign body, which cause there will history of coughing, choking, and unilateral wheeze will be there. Most of the localized wheeze will be there in case of foreign body expression. Cystic fibrosis is a genetic disease. What child have got other symptoms also of child may be malnourished, failure to thrive will be there, and chronic diarrhea will be there, and recurrent infection will be there, recurrent pneumonia will be there. Child may have got recurrent wheezing. What is the goal of the, means what is, how will you treat the bronchial asthma? Bronchial asthma, we can only control it. There is no any curative drugs, is not in bronchial asthma. Only control mate garna sakchhau, cure garna sakchhau. So what is the, how will you treat the bronchial asthma? The goals of childhood bronchial asthma management is maintain the normal activity, because due to persistent cough, due to underlying hypoxia, child may get easy fatigability, child have severe symptoms at night, child may not able to sleep at night, so there will be decreased activity will be there. So you have to improve the child activities so that the child can go for regular school and attendance will take place. Full participation in the physical exercise. So maintain the normal activities, one of the first goal of the treatment is. Prevent sleep disturbances, prevent chronic asthma symptoms, keep asthma exacerbation from the becoming severe one. So you have to prevent the severe attack, maintain the normal lung function, experience little to no adverse effect of the treatment, and identification and elimination of the exacerbating factors. So these are the goal of the asthma management. So you have to control. If you control the bronchial asthma, it is like a cure, the bronchial asthma. The child will be able to maintain the normal activity, can go to the school, can sleep at night, their study will get improved, and it can prevent the severe attack of the asthma, maintain the normal lung function. So these are the goal of the asthmatic management. Pharmacotherapy, basically we use two kind of drugs. One is bronchodilator. It's a short acting, like salbutamol. Sometimes if the child is having underlying allergy, anaphylactic reaction, in that case you can use the adrenaline, and sometimes you can use the terbutaline. Long acting like salmeterol, formoterol, you can use, but always you have to use along with the corticosteroid, salmeterol and formoterol. Short acting drugs commonly used as the salbutamol. Nowadays levosalbutamol is also we are using. Salbutamol, levosalbutamol. Levosalbutamol has got less side effect because less of tachycardia, tachyphylaxis, tremors. Mechanism of action of these drugs are airway smooth muscle relaxation and reduce the vascular permeability, improve the mucociliary clearance. One is preventer, one is reliever, other one is preventer. Preventer drugs like beclomethasone, budesonide, fluticasone. This will cause the, decrease the inflammation of the airway, decrease the edema of the mucous membrane, and it also decreases the secretions. So mechanism of action is inhibit cytokines production such as interleukin-1, tumor necrosis factor like alpha, interleukin-3, 4, 5, 6, 8, which will reduce the inflammation and bronchial hyper-responsiveness. Third one, basically these drugs are less commonly used nowadays. We use short acting, sometimes long acting bronchodilator along with the corticosteroid and corticosteroid. Mast cell stabilizer, less commonly used nowadays. So just to know the name, like bromoline sodium, nedobromyl sodium, ketotifen. Will decrease the IgE antibody induced release of inflammatory mediators from the sensitized mast cells. Decrease the inflammation, decrease the edema in that way. And other one is we can add on therapy. Nowadays we are using leukotriene modifiers, which will decrease the synthesis of leukotriene, like xylitol, antagonize the receptor, montelukast, zafirlukast, decrease the bronchoconstriction, cause the bronchodilation, decrease the hypersecretion from the gland, and inflammatory cell mediators which will decrease. So among these leukotriene modifier drugs, in children you are using montelukast. This montelukast you are using will cause bronchodilation, decrease the secretion, mucus secretion from the glands, and decrease the inflammatory cells. Stepwise approach for managing asthma. Severity and classification. According to the classification, you have to manage, you have to give the treatment to the children. So, classification wise, asthma, according to the severity of the asthma, it has classified as intermittent asthma, mild, moderate, severe. Depending on the symptoms, day and night symptoms, and depending on the age, less than 5 years, more than 5 years, and performance, the pulmonary function test, it has been classified. Like in intermittent asthma, the day-wise symptoms. Day symptoms will be less than 3 symptoms per week, and at night, less than 3 per month. In the child is less than 5 years of age, excellent exercise tolerance will be there, and more than 5 years of age, you do the pulmonary function test or peak expiratory flow rate that we have already discussed, which is more than or equal to FE1 or PEF. Peak expiratory flow is more or equal to 80%. That is normal in case of intermittent asthma. And peak expiratory flow from morning to evening relatively will be less than 20%. These are the symptoms and findings on pulmonary function test is there. You have to classify it as intermittent asthma. Similar wise, mild, moderate, severe. Mild, more than or equal to 3 symptoms per week. Nighttime symptoms, 3 to 4 symptoms per month. Exercise symptoms wise, there will be some symptoms on exercise. If they run, play, they become a little bit fatigability. They may have cough, on running, crying. And if you do the pulmonary function test, FEV1 or PEF will be more than or equal to 80%. And PEF variability will be 20 to 30%. Moderate asthma, there will be symptoms, will be daily symptoms, daily use of beta agonist, more than 1 symptoms per week. Frequent exercise symptoms will be there. Whenever child will play, they may become fatigability, they may have cough, may have difficulty in breathing, and more than 5 years of age, FEV1 will be more than 60 and less or between 60 to 80 will be there, and PEF variability will be more than 30%. Severe asthma, continuous symptoms will be there, frequent exacerbation will be there, frequent night symptoms will be there, means they will have very limited physical activities, they can't walk. You can talk, in that case, they become fatigued, breathless. And FEV1 or PEF will be less than or equal to 60%, and PEF variability will be more than 30%. So these are the classification of bronchial asthma. Before 2016, it has been classified as mild intermittent and mild persistent, moderate persistent, and severe persistent. Now that mild intermittent has been eliminated, like it has been like Tetra is intermittent and persistent has been eliminated. Today's classes up to this month. Likewise, different wise, if the child is having intermittent asthma, you just give the salbutamol, short acting beta 2 agonist bronchodilator in intermittent asthma. Just you give the salbutamol or levosalbutamol if the child is having intermittent asthma. If the child is having mild asthma, you can start the inhaled corticosteroid around 100 to 200 microgram per day of budesonide or 25 to 50 microgram of fluticasone. You can give up to 1 year of age, and every 3 months you have to evaluate the child, and if they are well controlled, you can decrease 25% every month, or you can keep for up to same drugs up to 9 months, and you can taper and discontinue drugs. And if there is any exacerbation of the child develop wheezing or cough, severe cough, so intermittently you can use the inhaled salbutamol. The child is having moderate bronchial asthma, you can start with fluticasone inhaler or budesonide inhaler between 200 to 400 microgram of budesonide or 50 to 125 microgram of fluticasone, and you have to monitor every first whether they have in control or not. You have to see, reevaluate the child after starting the treatment within 15 to 20, 30 days, and every 3 months you can evaluate the child, and later you can taper. And you don't want to use medium dose of corticosteroid, you can add montelukast, monter, along with inhaled corticosteroid, low dose inhaled corticosteroid with montelukast. The child is having severe bronchial asthma. In that case, you have to start moderate dose of corticosteroid, montelukast, or high dose of corticosteroid. The child is more than 12 years or more than 12 years, you can add long acting beta 2 agonist like salbutamol or salmeterol or formetrol. Okay, and every weekly you have to monitor, and once it get controlled, you have to evaluate every 3 months. You can control the bronchial asthma, but depending on the situation, sometimes child may grow out of asthma. The parental family history of strong family history of bronchial asthma is there. It has said that, research has said that 50% chance of once the child becomes old, they may grow out of asthma. If the high risk factor is not there, like parental history of bronchial asthma is not there, then there is, in most of the times, more than 80% of the children will grow out of the asthma. So in intermittent asthma, just I want to sum up, in intermittent asthma, as required, you give the just bronchodilator. In mild asthma, low dose inhaled corticosteroid along with, if required, salbutamol inhaler. Moderate asthma, medium dose corticosteroid or low dose corticosteroid with leukotriene antagonist like montelukast. In severe asthma, medium to high dose of corticosteroid along with leukotriene antagonist, or medium dose corticosteroid with long acting beta 2 agonist like salmeterol or formetrol. Okay, today's class is up to here. So I have covered part 1, part 2 of bronchial asthma today's only. Okay, or go bronchial asthma class then. And status asthmaticus will cover in emergency class, not now.